Good morning and welcome to worship. We are glad that you are with us this day. We are continuing our Lord's Prayer sermon series with the passage, "Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil." And facing the topics of evil and temptation requires courage. So I would like to open today with some thoughts on courage from poets. First from David White, who's one of my favorites. Courage is the measure of our heartfelt participation with life, with another, with a community, a work, a future. To be courageous is not necessarily to go anywhere or do anything except to make conscious those things we already feel deeply, and then to live through the unending vulnerabilities of those consequences. To be courageous is to seat our feelings deeply in the body and in the world, to live up to and into the necessities of relationships that often already exist, with things we find we already care deeply about, with a person, with a future, with a possibility in society, or with an unknown that begs us on and has always begged us on. Courage, he writes, is what love looks like when tested by the simple, everyday necessities of being alive. And then a blessing from John O'Donohue, who writes, "When the light around lessens and your thoughts darken until your body feels fear turn cold as a stone inside, when you find yourself bereft of any belief in yourself and all you unknowingly leaned on has fallen, when one voice commands your whole heart and it is raven dark, steady yourself and see that it is your own thinking that darkens your world. Search and you will find a diamond thought of light. Know you are not alone and that this darkness has a purpose. Gradually it will school your eyes to find the one gift your life requires hidden within this night corner. So invoke the learning of every suffering you have suffered. Close your eyes and gather all the kindling about your heart to create one spark. That is all you need to nourish the flame that will cleanse the dark of its weight of festered fear. A new confidence will come alive to urge you towards higher ground where your imagination will learn to engage difficulty as its most rewarding threshold." Amen.
Oh, Out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord. O Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my supplication. If you were to keep watch over sins, O Lord, who could stand? Yet with you is forgiveness, in order that you may be feared. I wait for you, O Lord, my soul waits, and your word is my hope. My soul waits for the Lord more than those who keep watch for the morning. O Israel, wait for the Lord, for with the Lord there is steadfast love. With the Lord there is plenteous redemption. For the Lord shall redeem Israel from all their sins. When we pass through deep waters or go through times of trial, God is with us. With confidence in God, our Creator and our Redeemer, let us confess our sins. We pray, save us from the time of trial. Help us to resist the temptations of spending more, using more, acquiring more, and wasting more. We pray, deliver us from evil. Free us from greed and self-centeredness that separate us from you and others. Do not be afraid, says the Lord, for I have redeemed you and you are mine. By the grace of God, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen.
peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all, and also with you. Please share a sign of peace with your neighbors.
Peace on high.
Good morning. It's wonderful to be back in the sanctuary with you for worship. Many thanks to our childcare team, to Elder Jennifer G., Elder Aaron King, Reverend Joanne Lee, for working together this summer to welcome children every Sunday. So thank you for that. Just opening this time, thinking about Frederick Buechner's thought, "Listen to your life." I love that quote. What do you think that it was like to be in the Garden of Eden? Could you see yourself surrounded by a good friend, plants, rivers, fruit trees, animals, and all that you needed? When I think about those things, I feel relaxed. I hope that you had a good summer and are excited to start school. Our household definitely had some anxiousness in the morning of the first day of school, but that seemed to go away once we got home from school and work. We were too tired to be anxious. Let's rewind to the summer. We went on vacation with our family to the East Coast, and I swam in the warm waters of the rivers, lakes, and swimming pool. In some way, it was similar to what I imagined the Garden of Eden to be. I finally had time to go into the water and hang out with our family. Think of a time when you had fun in the water. The Housatonic and Chepauk rivers were very low this August. We were able to wade in, walk over the rocks, and see the small crawdads. It was fascinating to see how the crawdads scuttled back through the water along the sand when they saw the shadow of my foot. When we stood in the middle of the river, it felt as though we were in a Roman bath, as though we could stand up and talk with each other forever. A damselfly kept on returning to the top of Chloe's head, so we laughed about it being her spirit animal that day. We were on God's time. It was still dangerous to climb over those slippery rocks in flip-flops and float around with the current. In some way, it was like the Garden of Eden, where Adam and Eve were able to be free, but they had to navigate the slippery rocks of taking the fruit that God had told them not to eat. I still have a few scrapes and bumps from stumbling on rocks when I tried to return to shore after floating with the current. Because I wanted to be in that water, I understood that the cost would be some minor bruises and scrapes. I wouldn't have missed that experience for anything. Have you had an experience where you climbed a tree or walked in nature and got a scrape or a mosquito bite? I'm sure that experience outweighed the annoyances. When I think about God telling Adam and Eve not to eat the fruit, I think about times when we want to do things that are not good for us. It's human and typical for us to want to do a lot of things, but it's good to take calculated risks that won't hurt us or other people in big ways. The moments of swimming in the warm river and lake seem simple, but it took a lot of planning for all the people to arrive in one place on a hot day when they had the time off. I love seeing frogs at the waterfall in the grass during an afternoon rain and in the pool. They seem to enjoy stillness. During the week, the weather became cool and windy. The water was not warm, so we didn't go swimming anymore. Being in the warm water the week before was like a Garden of Eden gift. I hope that you had moments in nature this summer where you felt free and knew that you are enough and you have enough. Let us pray. Creator God, you offer us a big world that is similar to the Garden of Eden. Help us to know what is good for us and to enjoy more of that. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As we continue in morning worship, may God be with you here. May God be with you there.
Prayer for illumination is found in your worship bulletin, and I invite you to pray with me. Holy One, we come to listen to the words of Jesus. May we hear his voice echoing through the centuries, inspiring us even now to follow. May our hearts be filled with courage to witness to his timeless call to love one another. Amen. The first reading is from the third chapter of Genesis, beginning with verse 8. They heard the sound of the Lord walking in the garden at the time of the evening breeze in the cool of the day. And the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord God called to the man and said to him, "Where are you?" The man said, "I heard the sound of you in the garden, and I was afraid. Because I was naked, I hid myself." The Lord God said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree of which I commanded you not to eat?" The man said, "The woman whom you gave to me, she gave me the fruit from the tree, and I ate." Then the Lord God said to the woman, "What is this that you have done?" And the woman said, "The serpent tricked me, and I ate." A reading from 1 Samuel chapter 8, beginning with verse 4. Then all the elders of Israel gathered together and came to Samuel at Ramah and said to him, "You are old, and our sons do not follow in your ways. Appoint for us then a king to govern us like other nations." But this displeased Samuel when they said, "Give us a king to govern us." Samuel prayed to the Lord, and the Lord said to Samuel, "Listen to the voice of the people in all that they say to you, for they have not rejected you, but they have rejected me from being king over them. Just as they have done to me from the day I brought them up out of Egypt to this day, forsaking me and serving other gods, so also they are doing to you. Now then, listen to their voice. Only you shall solemnly warn them and show them the ways of the king who shall reign over them." So Samuel reported all the words of the Lord to the people who were asking for a king, saying, "These will be the ways of the king who will reign over you. The king will take your sons and appoint them to his chariots and to be his horsemen and to run before his chariots. And he will appoint for himself commanders of thousands and commanders of fifties, and some to plow his ground and to reap his harvest and to make his implements of war and to the equipment for his chariots. He will take your daughters to be perfumers and cooks and bakers. He will take the best of your fields and vineyards and olive orchards and give them to his courtiers. He will take 1/10 of your grain and of your vineyards and give it to his officers and courtiers. He will take your male and female slaves and the best of your cattle and donkeys and put them to his work. He will take 1/10 of your flocks and you shall be his slaves. And in that day, you will cry out because of your king whom you have chosen for yourselves. But the Lord will not answer you in that day." The people refused to listen to the voice of Samuel. They said, "No, but we are determined to have a king over us so that we also may be like other nations and that our king may govern us and go out before us and fight our battles." The word of the Lord.
"Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil." I confess I spent a fair amount of time this week wondering why I had not generously let either Victor or Joanne preach today. But here we are. We'll talk both about the temptation part and the evil part, but we'll start with evil. Evil is a word used in lots of contexts, often about particular situations, but also in a bigger sense. Humans can do evil things, but we do not believe a human can be categorically evil. We trust God is always seeking the redemption of people who perpetuate evil, even when we can't see it or understand it. Darth Vader, Hitler, Pol Pot, Vlad the Impaler, and people who torture puppies absolutely do evil, but they are still children of God. And the evil they commit is at odds with who God is calling them to be. Many people who perpetuate evil acts learned that behavior because it was done to them when they were children or because they grew up in systems that rewarded it. Evil is a mystery to us, in truth. We don't understand it. And maybe we recognize there is the potential in each of us to participate in it. I don't understand gun violence. I don't understand what makes a person decide to go to a school or a concert or a parade or wherever and open fire. It feels evil to me. At the same time, I recognize that many of these young men, and most of the perpetuators of gun violence are young men, were baptized in churches when they were babies. They grew up hearing the stories of Jesus. Things go terribly wrong in this world sometimes, and we do not understand it. In scripture and in Christian tradition, evil is often personified or spiritualized as the evil one or Satan. One translation of the Lord's Prayer is, "Deliver us from the evil one." Presbyterian-flavored Christians are hesitant to hand over our responsibility for evil behavior to an unseen and unknown force. The devil made me do it, right? That feels more like an excuse for our own behavior than it does a good reason for why we did that behavior. So when I think of evil, I don't tend to think of a man in a red suit with horns. I picture people like us who, for whatever reason, have participated in and perpetuated evil acts. It keeps me vigilant and mindful that evil is not other. Evil can come from within. The Apostle Paul writes in the book of Romans, "I do not understand my own actions, for I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing I hate." The Holocaust, where at least 6 million people were killed by the Nazi regime in World War II, is a reminder of big systemic evil. And it happened because seemingly good people, many of them Christians, went along with it. Same with slavery. Between 1525 and 1866, in the entire history of the slave trade to the New World, according to the Transatlantic Slave Trade Database, 12.5 million Africans were shipped to the New World. 10.7 million survived the Middle Passage, disembarking in North America, the Caribbean, and South America. When we speak of evil in a system, we think about how rules and norms and cultures and laws and governmental structures enforce and legalize and systematize and reward evil. So to pray, "Deliver us from evil," is a challenging prayer. We're seeking for safety from outside forces and safety from inside ones. I don't want to be the victim of evil. I also don't want to be complicit in it. So what is the connection between evil and temptation? Friends, they walk hand in hand. And the translation of the word Satan is the tempter. But what tempts each of us is different. At the church I served in Boise, my secretary there really, really, really loved chocolate. And I like chocolate just fine, but I don't love it the way she did. So she would keep her chocolate in my office. It was safe on my desk. It was not a temptation to me the way it was for her. And if she was going to eat her chocolate, she had to walk all the way across the narthex to my office to get it. For me, I'm lucky that the things that I'm tempted by are not usually kept in candy dishes on desks. I would be in trouble if pizza or cute shoes or Warriors tickets were in front of me all day long. So what tempts us are different things. But in scripture, if you notice, the temptations are often big things. When Jesus is tempted in the wilderness by the tempter, he's tempted about worldly power. Adam and Eve are tempted by the knowledge of good and evil. Big things. But I suspect for Adam and for Eve, when the serpent talked them into eating the fruit, I bet it didn't feel like a big thing. I suspect it felt like a little thing. It's just one piece of fruit. How bad could that be? The Genesis account is a historically loaded text. It has long been used to blame women for all sorts of things, even in the Bible. The author of 1 Timothy writes in my absolute least favorite passage of scripture, I permit no woman to teach or to have authority over a man. She is to keep silent. For Adam was formed first, then Eve. And Adam was not deceived, but the woman was deceived and became a transgressor. Yet she will be saved through childbearing, provided they continue in faith and love and holiness with modesty. Since you just heard that Genesis text read, I trust that you are wondering, wait, Marcy, wasn't Adam a part of it? Didn't he eat the fruit too? Yes, yes, he did. Thank you for noticing. You are correct. These texts are used to keep women from full flourishing in the church, and not just in the church, but in society. This text is used to support theological understandings of the fall, where the garden of earthly delights is left for a life of labor and hard work because of original sin. But the word fall does not occur in this text, and neither does the word sin. If you've noticed, there was already labor in the garden. God put Adam and Eve in the garden to tend it, to protect it. They were not sitting on chaise lounges drinking piña coladas all day. The idea of work being a result of the fall is not correct. It's ironic, isn't it, that Scripture itself is used to keep half of humanity from full participation in the world. God calls us to resist evil and temptation, and the church uses that very story to justify what God calls us to resist. This text is used for a lot of things, but I think this text is really about showing us who we are. We are people who are called to till God's garden, people who are called to care for the gift of God's abundant creation that we've been given. And like Adam and Eve, we distrust God's very voice, giving us instructions for our flourishing. We instead trust the voices of tempters who call us to take on for ourselves the determination of what's good and what's evil. I understand why people have used this text for bigger theological constructions over the years, but we can't lose sight of the value that's in it. We're tempted by the little things that become big things. And perhaps we're so easily tempted because we doubt God's intentions for us, or maybe we doubt our status as God's beloved children. We seek our own glory and we trust other voices than God's. The story of temptation in the garden reminds me to listen for God. It reminds me to trust in God, and it reminds me to question the voices that try to tell me I don't need God's guidance and I don't need God's instruction. Lead me not into temptation is how most versions of the Lord's Prayer are translated. But Pope Francis has recently begun arguing that the Catholic Church should change the way they say it to better reflect what we know of God. Francis says we should pray, "Do not let us fall into temptation." And I think I agree with him in this. God does not lead us into trouble. We do that just fine all by ourselves. God heals us, God supports us, God forgives us, God transforms us, but God is not a trickster out to trap us. We find temptation without much effort at all. Adam and Eve are only 2 verses into their story in Scripture when the serpent shows up. 2 verses. Do not let us fall into temptation. The other story Victor read today shows us a more subtle kind of temptation, but it's also related to not listening to what God desires for us. Samuel was a good man and a good prophet, and his sons who were supposed to follow him were not good men or good leaders. Israel had been ruled by judges and prophets, all calling the people to listen for God. But the people were tired of prophets and they wanted kings. They looked to Babylon or Nineveh, Egypt or England, North Korea or Russia, and they thought, those rulers have gold palaces and big armies. They have lots of power and money. That's what we need. We're tired of being overrun by other armies. We're sick of power being spread out amongst 12 tribes. We want a king, someone who says what he thinks and will tell us what to do. Samuel knew that was a bad idea, but God said, give them what they want. They're not rejecting your leadership, they're rejecting mine. And Samuel laid out how bad it would be exactly. The king was going to take their sons for his army, their daughters to work in his castle, their crops to feed his army. The king would take portions of their wealth to build his wealth and to give it to his cronies. It does not sound appealing at all, does it? And the people say, sign us up, that sounds great. That's part of the challenge with temptation. It takes courage to listen for what God is calling us to do, for what God wants us to do. It's much easier to listen to a strong man. It takes courage to sit with the questions and the doubts and the complicated choices before us. It's easy to abdicate our responsibility and put the crown on someone else's head. Ultimately, I think issues of temptation often come down to enough. What's enough? How much money do we need to amass before we'll feel secure? How much power do we need to project before we'll feel in control? How many pairs of shoes is enough to have in my closet? Adam and Eve were living in paradise, and somehow it was not enough. In eating the fruit, they showed they did not know who they were. They did not trust who they were supposed to be. They wanted to be something else. In this case, they wanted to be wise and with the understanding of God. The people of Israel, they were God's chosen people. They were led by God through prophets and judges. They were claimed by God in a covenant, and it wasn't enough. By demanding a king, they showed that they did not know who they were or whose they were. Our experience with evil and with temptations may look similar, or it may look completely different from the ones we heard in Scripture. But as we pray the Lord's Prayer, I also offer us the reminder of courage. Evil happens when good people are silent. Evil can be thwarted when we speak up. In 1867, John Stuart Mill was speaking in Scotland, and he said, "Let not anyone pacify his conscience by the delusion that he can do no harm if he takes no part and forms no opinion. Bad men need nothing more to compass their ends than that good men should look on and do nothing. He is not a good man who, without a protest, allows wrong to be committed in his name, and with the means which he helps to supply, because he will not trouble himself to use his mind on the subject." Friends, as we pray this week, may we not fall into temptation, and may we be delivered from evil both within and without. Amen.
Friends, the very act of worship is an offering back to God, an offering of our time, our talents, and our treasure. If you are worshiping with us in person today, we invite you to please sign in on the pew pad so that we know that you were here. this is your first time worshiping with us, we invite you to just give us a little wave so that we know that you're here and might greet you. There is a welcome table in the atrium where we can get to know you better, and then there's coffee and treats in Calvin Hall, which is the big room across the atrium and through the doors. Your bulletin and website, our website holds details for upcoming events, for learning, and for community, and for opportunities for service. There's a young adult happy hour this Wednesday. There's a special soiree for music lovers next Sunday afternoon. There are volunteer opportunities, and please note that our homecoming Sunday is coming up on the 11th of September, which includes a shared meal following worship. We hope that you will look through your bulletin and join us for all that interests you or calls you to be with us. As we live our lives as an offering to God, your tithes and offerings will now be received.
Thank you. Take, O God, our lives and these gifts that we bring. May they be used to deliver us all from evil, so that all your people may live in your justice, love, and mercy. This we pray in your name. Amen. You may be seated. Throughout this sermon series, we have been using different versions of the Lord's Prayer, and today we use a version translated directly from the Aramaic by Calvary member Arlene Jeck. Arlene is no longer able to join us in person for worship, and so we pray for her and remember her as we pray together this Lord's Prayer. Let us pray. God, we come to you this morning in prayer and supplication. We pray for the world because we know that you, O God, love it so. For every place that faces violence and war, we pray, remembering this week that thin place of Chautauqua and the violence experienced there. We pray for the divisions and hate that rip the fabric of our society, for poverty and hunger that plague your people while others live in opulence, for those being deported from countries they know to countries unknown, we pray. For those seeking asylum and refuge in new countries, we pray. Help us to live in your economy, helping build a world that is just and fair, where all may have the opportunity to thrive. We pray for the church because it is Christ's body living and working in the world. We pray for the leaders of Calvary as they discern how to best nurture, inspire, and transform. We pray for those in this community who are homebound, hospital-bound, and in need of healing. We pray especially for people who are sick and hungry, lonely, or without homes. And we pray for the city of San Francisco and the neighborhoods where we live. This week, we remember our students and teachers returning to a place that should be safe, but is too often plagued by gun violence. And finally, we pray for all your creation. And we pray for clean air, water, and soil, for those suffering from wildfires and floods and other natural disasters. Help us to be better stewards of this earth, and may the work of the whole church show and tell the good news of Jesus Christ. This we pray in the name of Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, O beloved, who is everywhere, focus your light within us, make it useful. Create your reign of unity now. Your one desire then acts with ours, as in all light, so in all forms. Grant what we need each day in bread and insight. Loose the cords of mistakes binding us as we release the strands we hold of others' guilt. Don't let surface things delude us. From you is born all ruling will, the power and the life to do, the song that beautifies all. From age to age it renews. Truly power to these statements. May they be the ground from which all our actions grow, sealed in trust and faith. Amen.
Thank you.
theologian Frederick Buechner died, and he said, "Here is this world, beautiful and terrible things will happen. Do not be afraid." Friends, receive now this benediction from the Reverend William Sloan Coffin. May God give you grace to never sell yourself short, grace to risk something big for something good, and grace to remember that the world is now too dangerous for anything but truth and too small for anything but love. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Amen.